Where we're going to next is super, super small. Scotland has about 5.47 million citizens overall. That's tiny. That's like, that's smaller than KZN. That's smaller than, no, it's way smaller than Eastern Cape. But that's Scotland. That's Scotland. Just to give you a bit of context, they're sitting at 4,229 confirmed cases. That's a lot. The numbers are reaching 1.4 million corona positive cases worldwide. So you can just get an idea of how bad things are in some areas. I know one of the most affected areas is the United Kingdom, where we're going to be going this morning to have a conversation with Oos Nenhlanhla Zondo. Let me go find her. Boom, sir. The strangers that become friends.
Hey.
How are you?
I'm all right. How are you?
I can hear you well and nice. I see you with your nice hair. Seems like a natural hair advocate there.
I tried. I'm not a morning person, so I tried.
Hey, it's like, well, for us, it's 11:30. What time is it on your side?
It's 10:30. I'm usually trying to crawl out of bed at this time, so. Yeah.
I was me. Gandhi was like, I saw that cutscene.
Ekai is a different story.
Because you know the drill.
Yeah, of course.
Anyway, say thank you so much for agreeing to do the show with us and for us to know you a bit during this pandemic and this crazy time. We absolutely are excited. I can see a couple of waves coming through. People are excited to have you on. You and the comment section, even yesterday, hey, people are already commenting. We had a comment that said, he's always been an exceptional student at great.
Shout out to Lona. Yeah, high school buddy.
So I was like, so definitely that's going to be a good interview.
Yikes, the pressure. Oh my word.
I guess.
Who am I? Well, now I'm a PhD student at the University of Strathclyde doing my public health and health policy degree. I just got here 4 months ago. It actually feels like I've been here longer.
I see there's ancient buildings and stuff.
Yeah, the architecture here is amazing. But I'd say that it's a lot like Peter Maritzburg. I don't know if you do. Yeah.
In
a post office. Yeah, Peter Maritzburg buildings are really old and have that, you know, that ancient colonial vibe.
And how's the adjustment been like? Well, judging from these poses, you're getting quite comfortable, girl.
I had to show up for the gram. Everything's still all good. And there's a couple of African shops here, so I can get my maize meal and pegu poo too, you know.
Oh, nice.
And, you know, just chill. That was a hectic day. It was so hot. I was sweating. Everything was just melting.
This is your mom.
This is mommy. Yay. I know my brother's in there in the comments somewhere. So yeah, that's him on the that'll be your left.
Oh, snap. Oh, and this is your actual graduation day.
Yeah.
Lalela, guys, it's a Master's of Medical Science in Public Health. Okay, girl.
I'd say it's been smooth so far, except for this, you know, this corona. It's been really, really hard. I mean, for the first 2 weeks, I just slept. The only thing I did was check my emails and, you know, watch certain things. But I think it wasn't sleeping because, you know, I was lazy or tired or anything. It was almost like, it was like a shock. Like, okay, now what? What do I do? How do you continue doing your research if you don't know what's going to happen next week? You know, will my PhD matter? Like, you know, the world could really just, you know, go down. And here I am still trying to, you know, interview people about their mental health. It's just, you know, it kind of caught me off guard and threw me off balance a little bit. But our university is very, very good with keeping in touch with people. So I've been chatting to my supervisors, chatting to other students, and, you know, they're trying to help us, you know, figure it out and just continue working, even though it really is hard. But, Yeah, I mean, I'm just continuing as normal. Well,
Yeah.
now for my room, but yeah. I mean, my scholarship is 3 years, so if I don't finish it in 3 years, I'm screwed. So
Yeah.
I have to do it in 3 years.
Yeah. So
Yeah.
what's the conversation that you guys have been having with your parents, with your mom and stuff?
Well, she wanted me to come home. She thought that I should come home, but there was a lot of things to consider. I'm no longer under medical aid at home because, I canceled that when I left. So I mean, I'm asthmatic as well, so that would put me at risk for, yeah, I'm part of that group. So I, logically it makes sense for me to stick around. So that's the kind of conversation I had to just, have with her and my brother. And I just told her that, it actually makes more sense for me to stay put. Firstly, because of, the fact that I don't have medical aid. And here, I mean, the NHS is free for everybody, So I'd be able to get help if necessary. And yeah, so here I am. But she constantly calls me. Yesterday she saw the poster of the lockdown show, and she was like calling me. She's like, "Who put you up? What happened?" She didn't fully understand what was going on.
Thank you, Patty.
Right, thank you, Patty. And she
Yeah.
didn't fully understand what it meant, and I was like, no, calm down, man." She's like, "Oh, I thought you were like in trouble." I'm like, no. So I think for her, she's still a bit anxious, she
Yeah.
keeps calling me to check if I'm okay. And yeah,
Yeah.
tough
So
times.
then I have to naturally ask, what was your mind frame when this hits the UK? And obviously the big criticism in the UK was that the government there just didn't respond quick. What was
Yeah.
your response? Do you first go to your doctor? Do you start Googling and researching because you are asthmatic? So what's
Yeah.
going through your head? What does logic and, reason say to you?
Well, yeah, definitely. I contacted my doctor first thing. Unfortunately, at my doctor's building, somebody had tested positive, so I couldn't go there physically. So I had to call in and let them know. And for me, it was more important for me to make sure that I could get my inhaler. Even after, if this goes on for 6 months, I need to be able to pick up my inhaler from somewhere. So
Yeah.
yeah, that's the first thing I tried to sort out. And I got my inhaler, I got an extra inhaler just in case. And the next thing was just for me to stay indoors. And people really weren't taking this seriously here. I mean, the moment we went on lockdown, families started coming out and playing in the playground. And I was just looking out from my window, like, wait, what? This is not a holiday. This is not no holiday.
But I do want to continue on the point of mental health. You study mental health, right? That's something very close to you. And in your particular case, you're asthmatic. You're in a foreign country. Just 4 months into your PhD journey, I have to ask the question of how's your own mental health like in this point in time? Because yesterday you guys recorded the highest count ever in Scotland. So what's the direction? And
I
how you?
mean, naturally, I'm somebody who gets anxious very easily. I mean, even before coming onto this live, I was like, panicking, but now I'm okay. So yeah, like when this whole thing started getting really serious, I'm not gonna lie, I started feeling my chest close up and I was starting to use my pump a bit more. I started doing all sorts of things like steaming. And trying to rub vapor up on my chest. I really, and in my head I felt like I was experiencing symptoms, but honestly, I don't have a cough, I don't have a fever, and I don't really have the typical symptoms that go with COVID-19. So I would say it was anxiety, and I still feel it even to this day. Like this morning I felt like, okay, I'm alive. Let's try get through this day. And every day it's like you wake up and you're like, okay, thank God I'm alive. Let me just try get through each day, because I constantly feel like my chest like is just closing up. But yeah, it is what it is.
Yeah. So today I want to know, what are some of the procedures you have in place at home? Do you have your sanitizers in check? Besides just the asthma pump for your asthma, what else do you have? What are some of the things you're paranoid about? How many times are you even washing your hand? What protocol is going on?
Right. I actually don't have any sanitizer. By the time I was trying to get sanitizer, it was sold out. I don't even have a mask. I don't have gloves. But my logic behind it is that if I do need to step out, I ensure that I don't touch my face, of course, and I ensure that I keep a distance from people. Mm. And for me, I just try to, you know, be aware. Like, I don't walk around and just, you know, as I used to. I make sure that when I'm walking around, I know that people need to, you know, don't come close to me. Because, I mean, personally, I can't say that I'm negative either. I could be a carrier, you know. So even that, it's just like, I don't want to be somebody spreading it if, you know, I am sick. And I don't want to be somebody who, you know, gets it if I'm not. So, yeah, I mean, and, you know, when I step from, when I come back inside, I obviously take off the clothes I've been wearing and I wash my hands thoroughly before I do anything. And I also clean up my phone because, you know, that's like the worst. Yeah, that's the worst. I mean, what's the point of washing your hands and touching your phone again? So, yeah, those are kind of things that I do. Yeah.
And the point of mental health, you study mental health, right?
Yeah.
That's something very close to you. And in your particular case, you're asthmatic, you're in a foreign country. Just 4 months into your PhD journey, I have to ask the question of how's your own mental health like in this point in time? Because yesterday, you guys recorded the highest count ever in Scotland. So what's the direction?
Naturally, I'm somebody who gets anxious very easily. I mean, even before coming onto this live, I was like, you know, panicking, but now I'm okay. Like when this whole thing started getting really serious, I'm not gonna lie, I started feeling my chest close up and I was starting to use my pump a bit more. I started doing all sorts of things like steaming and, you know, trying to rub vapor up on my chest. You know, I really, and, you know, in my head, I felt like I was experiencing symptoms. But, you know, honestly, I don't have a cough. I don't have a fever. And, you know, I don't really have the typical symptoms, you know, that, you know, go with COVID-19. So I would say it was anxiety. And I still feel it even, you know, to this day. Like this morning, I felt like, okay, I'm alive. Let's try to get through this day. And every day it's like you wake up and you're like, okay, thank God I'm alive. Let me just try to get through each day, you know, because I constantly feel like my chest, like, it's just closing up. But, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah. The big thing about this pandemic is that a lot of governments are obviously trying to make a lot of changes and shifts into how they're doing things. And I know where you are in Scotland, they're also trying to see what they can do. In fact, I think there was a medical set up in Glasgow as well for specific people with coronavirus. I want to know how safe do you feel medically? In Scotland, do you feel safe medically if anything happens?
Yeah, I actually do feel very, very safe here, because as I said, the NHS is a very good healthcare system that they have here. But I am a bit nervous because, you know, obviously the burden of you know, the different facilities is getting really high, so they don't have enough ventilators and they don't have enough beds for people. So, you know, for me, it's more of a worry, like, if I get it and I need to be sent to critical care, would I even have a space? Like, would there even be room for me, you know? So, I mean, they are trying, but, you know, the numbers are really just, you know, really collapsing the system right now. So, I mean, if you do test positive and you have mild symptoms, you are told to stay home. They don't take you in or anything like that. So they only take you in once you're like in really critical condition, and often that's too late. So, you know, that really scares me. But as I said, I try to not think about it and try to just go on by my day. So, you know, we're allowed to take jogs. So, I mean, I take a jog, work out, and, you know, just try to keep a positive mind.
In South Africa, they have set up a couple of relief funds to try help different people from different sectors. Whether for us, like, I mean, arts and culture and freelancers, even in the economic sector as well, they've really tried. On your side, has anything been tried? I know back to our side, sorry, is that some of the regulations included foreign nationals. For example, if you're a shop owner for Ispaza shop, South Africa, no more yen, I know. So there are things that people say discriminated against foreign nationals. So I'm keen to find out from you, as a foreign national there, are you treated differently in any way? Do you feel like some regulations are just safeguarding people from the UK? Is there any prejudice?
Unfortunately, as a tier 4 visa, which is a student visa, I'm not entitled to any public funds. So I can't get any funds from the government per se, but the university has set up a couple of funds. I mean, hey, our university, bani man. Bani man, let me tell you that. Bani man. So they've got a COVID. Bani mali. Bani mali. And it's not a public institution. So they fund it privately. So people give the money. They have set up a COVID-19 a fund. So if you're experiencing any hardship, like hardships in terms of you financially, you are allowed to apply for it, and they will give you some money. But it's to their discretion, obviously. So they can decide how much they're giving you. Because I mean, most international students do part-time work. That's how we stay afloat, and that's how we get money, you know, to do what we want to do now and then. So, you know, we missing out because we can't work. So they've set up that fund for, you know, for people to apply for and get some money.
But I always thought you guys that get these international funding, is that what do they call it, the money that you get given, the stipend?
Like a stipend. It depends. There are various, they are different. It depends who's funding you. Like, for example, I know some friends of mine who are being funded by the Nigerian government back home. Mm. And they get like a stipend, and they get their tuition paid, but they say that it's not enough. So usually, you know, the scholarships will kind of cover like the bare minimum. So, you know, often, I mean, I'm sure you've heard that, you know, UK life is very expensive. So,
yeah,
if you want to go out with friends, for example, you need to, you know, you have to have your own money. And I mean, here they have a minimum wage. So working really does help, because you could make so much money out of just doing 4 hours of work per week. So it's not even like anything serious. It's just like, you know, you do something for 4 hours and you get some money for that week.
Mm. So yeah. How are you going to survive not working? Do you have some money saved? And
stuff? No, I'm covered, luckily.
You're all in university.
No, I'm covered, luckily. But I am going to apply for the hardship fund, because, I mean, why not? I am being affected by it, but I wouldn't say I'm stressed out about my finances right now. But
if they stretch the long term, will you still kind of be fine, or you'd have to probably
No, I think I'll be fine even if it's long term right now. I mean, also think about it this way, like, since we're in lockdown, you kind of save a lot of money. Because you don't have to, I don't have to leave the house. Yeah. I don't have, like, I have to buy a bus ticket for, I have to buy a monthly bus ticket. That's already £47 that I'm not paying for, you know, and that's a lot of money. So, you know, it's great that I'm indoors. I'm not spending any money. So,
Okay.
There's a lot of saving going on.
Okay, let me just welcome everybody back. Hello, guys. If you've just joined us, this is Lockdown Abroad with myself, Nondabeko Sipisi. I'm having a conversation with Ne Zondo. You can see there her profile. She's currently studying in Scotland at the moment. That's her living her best life. So we just get an idea of how her life is like as an academic who has actually just only spent 4 months here in Scotland. You can see there what the kind of vibes are like. You can see the ancient buildings that she described that look almost like the capital town of KwaZulu-Natal. You can see she deeply loves some of the artwork that's there, big painted buildings. A bit of nostalgia. Nani guys, especially even in Grahamstown, actually. I went to Rhodes University. Grahamstown also looks like this kind of old town. You can see Usne living her best life, guys. And this is her... this is her... university where she's studying. So I'm just recapping for all of you guys that have just joined in now, so you can just catch up. This is her graduating from the University of KwaZulu-Natal in medical science and her master's degree. This is her graduation day right there. And basically today we're just having a conversation with her, catching up and seeing how she's doing in this pandemic, especially Scotland, knowing that there are over 4,000 people affected with coronavirus, and they're really trying to step up with a couple of measures to make sure that everything is fine. So Snare, one of the things I also wanted to talk about was, oh, sorry guys, you can ask questions, please, at the bottom, so that it's not just me and Snare talking.
Yeah.
Upalisa uti Snare, you look beautiful. Thank you. I also
thank you. Thanks, guys. I feel like I'm so puffy though. Like, I'm really not a morning person.
So Snare is one of those people that have their Instagram account closed. So I sent through a request. When I opened it, I was like, boom. Is this what's up? Like, it's the first time I'd been to Scotland virtually, guys. So understand, it is going down. Kunta says, nice one. Melo says, hello. Thank you so much, guys, for joining in.
Hey, guys.
Luazi, I see you. Kunta says, I'm tuning in from Germany. Hey, what up, Kunta? Hey. We must have a conversation, Kunta, if you're keen. Karabo, hello. Azondo, success. Daga, I see you guys. TK, I see all of you guys. Thank you for joining in our conversation. Kunta saying, how are you doing in Africa now, my people? At the moment, I won't lie, it was a bit of a rocky start. When it was still in China, it was still like, it's a lot like China.
Yeah, everybody thought that. Yeah.
And then when it hit South Africa, everyone was like, and then it hits KZN. My mom asked, like, when ma, la lena, oh, la lena, oh.
Yeah, and people were like, hey, bro, it's not for black people. And we were just like, whew, thank God.
Right. And then, I thought Idris Elba had it.
Yeah, I was about to say, and then Idris Elba was like, hey.
Right.
It's been a roller coaster, man.
Hey, so to answer your question, it's been really scary, but I won't lie, like, President Cyril Ramaphosa for us has really been taking really decisive stance. Like, he did a lockdown straight up and effectively, and went hectic on it. Like, even taxis were reduced to 50%, and then they, but we won't talk about that. But there are a lot of measures done. There were relief funds that were set out. So I think they did quite well. The only thing that I worry about is that I come from Elokshin, Lasehana State, right? So a lot of people are saying, but akekho umuntu oduze wami oshonile. So kahle kahle lento, you know, lentisa le kude. So a lot of people are starting to see that there's a positive impact. They decreased, they less people affected. So now people are wanting to take their chances. So that's a bit of a scary thing. But lockdown is still effective. People are getting arrested. Imgruvo, ipeli, udala, ubegita, lalela, ubegita. There was a soundbite I saw yesterday in the news. Uzi, breaking in a bottle store. Hey, let's go to a bottle store and go to a wedding house. Hey, wanna let? Okay. So I'm keen to maybe find out from your side. If unlike us, people have been alcohol and they be found fatigued, because the biggest thing from our side was they cut a number of folks that were forcing it to jog. As you're not allowed to jog, a few people are forced to jog, saying they want to walk their dogs. So people were trying to push and test the lines, even in alcohol places, people can gather. So how have you guys been doing? Is everyone being respectful?
No. Really, they have not, to be honest. As I was saying, like, when the whole lockdown started here, people literally went out in numbers and started having big old party. Kids were playing. I mean, you barely see kids playing outside here because of the weather, firstly. But the moment there was a lockdown, it's just that people thought it was a big old holiday. And here, I mean, the supermarkets sell alcohol as well. So alcohol hasn't been shut down here. So people are still buying alcohol. But bars and restaurants have been shut. So they can't gather in bars and restaurants, but they are still, you know, buying alcohol. Yesterday I went out for a jog and I was so surprised to see how many people are just, you know, chilling in like open spaces. There's just no urgency. There's no sense of, you know, urgency to the people, yeah, really. So it's not just South Africans. People just don't listen. People say that it's their human right to be able to step out. So I mean, what can the government do, really?
I've got a question here, Snare. from Nyashiki's saying, I guess, based on your hair, is it hard getting natural hair products?
Not at all, actually. They have quite a few African shops here. So there's an African shop in the city center that I just really just buy my stuff from. And yeah, so it's not hard. It's really not that hard.
Okay, cool. Now, another part of our conversation was going to be you in academia, someone who does a PhD. And I remember just looking at, I just kept on thinking of, personally for me, it was my own brother. Well, back then, I don't think society and the community knew what an academic is.
Was, right?
Like, people just didn't get that there's academia and there are people that just, you know, dedicate their lives to academics. Yeah. So what is it about you, and do people understand what you're doing socially, particularly back home?
Well, my family is very supportive. So, I mean, I try to explain to them what it means to be an academic and what it means to, you know, pursue a PhD. But obviously, you know, there are some people who don't understand. But being an academic is basically selling your soul to research and reading and writing. What I do is, you know, do research on various topics, depending on my personal interests, or maybe grants, like you get a grant where they give you a large sum of money and they say, we need you to do this or investigate this. Like, you know, my previous job that I did mention earlier about lung cancer, where they were given a grant and, you know, we were employed to do the carry out the research in KwaZulu-Natal. So that's basically what an academic does. And when you produce this research, it's not just going to, you know, collect dust in the library. It's actually used to inform policies and, you know, change the world and kind of put more meaning to certain topics. I mean, I wouldn't say that as a PhD a student, I'm going to change the world, but my work will be a piece of the puzzle in changing something.
That is
basically academia. That's what it's about. But most of the academics are also lecturers. They usually are found in universities. Some are in, you know, NGOs, and they start, like, you know, organizations that will carry out research and do certain initiatives and interventions.
Yeah. Since you're saying your intention was initially to go into academia, how have you found the industry of academia? For example, are there complaints of patriarchy? Are there complaints of representation and visibility, particularly as a Black African woman?
Yeah, no, definitely. There's actually an article I read not so long ago. It was on The Guardian. It was about Black women in academia and how they are treated and how there's discrimination and there's not much growth, you know, for Black women. And I mean, honestly, it is true. It really is true. I mean, I wouldn't say that, you know, in UKZN, you know, is problem, but, you know, seeing what was working in a department where there were a lot of Black women, but it was very, like, downplayed, you know, their role in the research world was very downplayed. It was just like, okay, she's just doing another study. And, you know, when I'd send it to people that I know, like my brother and stuff, he'd read it and be like, whoa, this is amazing work. This is stuff that people don't really realize is attached to you, because all they see is the organization. They see the people who are standing in front of, you know, the TV screens, but they don't realize who's doing the work behind the scenes, which are often young Black, you know, people. So, yeah, I mean, it is going to be a very difficult journey for me. But obviously I'm not planning to stick around here. So I'm planning to go back into Africa and try to, you know, do some work over there. And I think that there's more opportunities for Black people in Africa than in the UK. So,
Is the academic space much more liberal in comparison to Israel's patriarchy, actually?
I don't know about other provinces in South Africa, but yeah, KZN, I mean, we know is still, you know, very patriotic and very, you know, they're not forward thinking in terms of, you know, academic spaces and even just the corporate world. But even here in Scotland, in our university, we have a equality and diversity department, or where they try to ensure that, you know, we all get equal chances. But, you know, these are just, I'd say, like smoke screens just to, you know, make it seem like, you know, they are really trying to diversify the place. But in actual fact, the academics that you see in front of you, my supervisors and everybody around them, are white. And yeah, there aren't any Black academics that I know of in my department.
So then, are there any support structures for you that are there to help you in this transitioning process, technically, that are on campus and available for you to use?
Yeah, we have an international, I think it's an international department, an international students department. They send us emails now and then of different activities that you can participate in to try and, you know, ease the transition. I unfortunately haven't attended any because, you know, my schedule's a bit busy. But yeah, they have certain departments for that.
Now, you're 4 months into your PhD, and we're talking about how allowing the spaces and not allowing spaces. How do you feel about your own voice? Is it affirmed? Is it validated? Or since you're 4 months in, are you still like kind of struggle to find the comfort zone? How are you navigating that?
I mean, I must say that it's not easy. I've spoken to a couple of people who are in organizations that are not affiliated to the university, and they've all told me the same thing. They're like, it's not going to be easy. Firstly, because the group that I've targeted is like a huge, like it's a minority group in here. Like there's no one really cares because there's only 0.5%. But I mean, 0.5% of 5 million people, that is quite a large group, you know, that doesn't mean that they don't exist. So, and there is no research on what I'm doing currently. So there's like absolutely nothing. I'll be the first. It is a bit difficult because it's just trying to break barriers that, you know, have not been touched before. I mean, they do talk about, you know, stigmatization of mental health, but very surface level, and they kind of generalize immigrants. And I mean, you can't compare Asians to Africans. That you just can't do that. You can't generalize a population like that. There's a lot of cultural differences in between there that will obviously affect, you know, mental health and how they use the services. So I've seen a lot of, you know, research done on other populations, but, you know, Africans are not represented here. But yeah.
And it sounds like, well, you are pioneering new ground. And then I'm interested to find out then, how much pressure are you inflicting on yourself, especially in a space like there's no guidance.
Yeah.
So that means you have to balance self-pressure and discipline.
Yeah. I mean, people always say that, you know, PhD is kind of like a mental challenge as well, because you kind of, you're leading yourself, and, you know, you're walking through a valley or a journey that you don't even know where it's going to take you. So, you know, it is a bit difficult. I do actually feel the pressure, and I have to meet with my supervisors like every month, and every month I don't have to have something to show, but I have to be able to engage on something. And often, you know, I'll sit in those meetings and I'll just tell them that, you know, I'm having a hard time doing something. And they're like, that is part of the process. You know, having a mental block and having a hard time getting somewhere is part of the process. You need to figure out why you're having that problem and how to go about, you know, unraveling your mind. So, yeah, it's very difficult, I must say. It's extremely difficult.
It sounds like you have to dogodela yourself, eh?
Yeah, basically.
You work in this space, and now you have to use the same tools to dogodela yourself and make sure that you're fine, you know, that you're not anxious. And how are you treating yourself, right? You told me that you like playing basketball.
Yeah, I actually found a group of ladies here who play basketball. So it's been great. I used to go every weekend, but now obviously, I mean every Wednesday, sorry. But now obviously we can't because of the virus. But yeah, we still keep in contact, and yeah. And I'm a person that can be alone. So I'm okay being in my room watching stuff and reading and, you know, just hanging out.
I'm trying to think. I'm scrolling through your pictures as well, and I'm trying to see if this girl's always on holiday and she loves to travel. How is she surviving lockdown? Because none of this, hey? None of this.
I mean, those are just like a few moments of my 28 years of life. So I wouldn't say I'm somebody who I like to travel, but I don't travel a lot. I really do like, I enjoy traveling, but I haven't really traveled a lot.
Okay, I see you, girl. I see
I
you.
see a comment from Alexa. Thank you.
Whoa, that's love. Okay,
Yeah.
listen. Melissa says, good luck with your studies. It's inspiring to see young black women growing academically and being independent. May God bless you. Thank you for being with us this morning. Essay, love you.
Oh, thank you.
Tell them how nervous you were, man. Tell them how nervous you were.
I was extremely nervous. I didn't want to be doing a live thing. I thought we were going to be able to edit some stuff, but yeah, I mean, I can be awkward sometimes, so. Yeah, but no, I'm chilled now.
And I'm so glad that you actually watched yesterday's one. It gives you an idea.
Yeah, no, definitely. Shout out to the lady before me. She was amazing. She was amazing. Yeah.
Now you guys, I've actually been like, I've got such an amazing bunch. And somehow, specifically, it's been a group of black women as well, except for one
Right.
man, who was male, sorry, I guess the first guest. But it's been actually nice getting to know people. But you talked about some of the things that you used to do part time, well, to pass time, basketball, and now you're just basically pretty much running. But some of the things that you do like to do, saying that you like watching your shows,
Yeah.
like you about your shows.
Yeah, I'm very addicted to crime reality. Like it's ridiculous. But I think why I'm addicted is because I'm so interested in understanding the psyche of the people that they talk about. Like you hear some ridiculous stories there, and these are true stories. So, I always try to figure it out. Oh, this must be a sociopath. Oh no, this guy is definitely narcissistic. Oh, So yeah, I mean that's what I mean I watch those things like every day, every single day. I'm watching something.
What goes into the type of content that you consume and the choice of consume? Fine, you do crime, but do you like it being much more informative? Do you like it being
Yeah.
much more humorous? What is it that you look for in shows?
For me, it's more informative. I like to, as I said, I like to learn about.
That was weird. You're the
Oh.
first person I've reached a 1 hour mark in one session.
Really? Woohoo! I hope I can watch this afterwards, so I hope
You
I get
will,
sick.
you will. So it
Okay.
doesn't save automatically. So what I do is that I play it back and then I record it. And then
Okay.
what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start a new category on my YouTube channel, and then I'm
Okay.
gonna post it so you can have it. But I'll
Okay,
edit it
great.
so nicely that we're scrolling through so that it's something that you can always remember.
Yeah.
Definitely, I'll definitely do that. Anyway, guys, welcome back. For those of you guys who are joining in now on this live or did cut out, today I'm speaking to Usne Zondo. She is based in Scotland. Again, this is her profile that is at SNAE right now. This is her currently studying towards her PhD in Scotland in the UK. So we're communicating with her to find out how she's coping in this pandemic. If you are keeping up with stuff that's happening in the UK, you'd understand. The cases of increased positive cases of corona are quite alarming. So they're trying to step up with a couple of measures. May's in there 4 months into her PhD. She can come home. This is her university. And basically, we can with her to find out if you tuned in, you've missed a lot of the conversation. I would suggest
Yeah.
you go back. Like we say,
Yeah.
so Okay, wait. Let me just check. I don't want to miss any comments. I saw something coming through.
PhD
Thank you for the interview. Very informative. That was Zondo. Thank you very much. Mankosi, yes. PhD in, yeah.
public health and health policy.
Just curious, Mam Kize, do you guys get
Hey,
paid as
Mamkize.
SA universities pay for PhD? That's a
No, not at all. That's actually a huge problem that I encountered when I was trying to get here, is that no South African government structure would give me any form of funding for being here. Wow. So yeah. Yeah. Says a lot. I mean, a lot of my other friends, like as I said earlier, from Nigerian, the Nigerian country, they have funding, like fully funded by the government, because the government believes that they are equipping them with, you know, skills that they'll bring back into the country. So, I mean, you know, I haven't had any, you know, funding from the government. But yeah. I do actually have an interesting story about some of my funding. So,
Tell us, girl.
It's very interesting, I'd say.
People are interested there. Yeah.
So last year, about October or August, around then, firstly, I didn't have funding, as I said, for a study in Cambridge. And that was like a lot of money. So then I was like, you know what? Let me go on Twitter. Let me try my luck. So I go on Twitter. And I tweet the Ujiwa King tweet.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, and I put everything there that, you know what, I've been accepted in these three universities. I don't have any funding. I really need to go by September, October. Mm-hmm. And funny enough, it was a Friday. Funny enough, like 30 minutes later, I got a DM amongst other DMs that I was getting. One DM is like, a friend of mine wants to fund you. Please get in contact. Gives me an email address. I'm like, what?
Okay, cool.
Right? So then I had to produce £2,000 for my deposit here at Strathclyde. £2,000.
I'm going to do a calculation.
That was like 30-something thousand at the time. Ooh. Yeah. It's probably higher now because, you know, obviously the rand is lower. But then I was like, okay, cool. I emailed this person and he's like, okay, I'll give you the money. Just like that. And I was like, wait, what? I mean, I'm not going to mention any names because obviously they can't help everybody. So, you know, I can't be put. They actually watch people on Twitter and, you know, select the people that they are able to help. And yeah, and I know, right? And then, yeah, like a week later, I was in touch with his accountant or a lady that was in charge of, you know, his accounts. Yeah. And it was transferred. They asked me for my details. I was like, don't give it to me because, you know, I don't want people to think that I'm scamming. I produced all the proof and they just put it through to Strathclyde and boom, my deposit was paid. And that was it.
And he didn't want anything back.
No.
He wasn't judgy about anything.
He just said, go out there, be great, and come back and help our people. And I was like, I definitely will.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's amazing. Wow. Humble, humble person. Amazing, amazing person.
Wow. When someone shows you a life like that, hey?
Right? Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah, and they kept in contact asking me, you know, how is everything? And, you know, how, just keep us, you know, updated. And I kept emailing them and texting them that, okay, I've got my visa, I'm leaving. Okay, here, I'm here now. And yeah, I mean, it's been a very eye-opening experience, honestly.
Yeah, yeah. I'm sure it might make you want to do something for other.
Definitely.
Like that as well. Like,
definitely,
when someone gives you a chance like that, hey, it makes you appreciate that this person had the resources and they took a chance for me that made a life-changing impact.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I do want to actually start a blog. It's just that, you know, I don't have any time, but I do want to start a blog to help anybody who would like to study abroad. You know, there are various opportunities. There are so many opportunities out here. And, you know, it's been a learning process for me. So I've learned quite a few tricks and, you know, things that you need to do to make sure that you get through successfully. So I'm willing to share that knowledge, you know, to anybody who wants to study abroad.
Okay, Mom Kiza says, are you planning to do your PhD for 3 years?
Yeah, 3 years.
Yeah. So, but you're telling us now about that there are so many opportunities. I've checked. Even the Netherlands, there's one called Newfic.
Yeah.
Like embassies have quite a few links that say, if you Google study abroad, many come up. But my graph with some of them is that even with a lot of like funding institutions, that there's a prerequisite for you to be a flippin' brainy ass.
Yeah. Like, unfortunately, unfortunately, I mean, they want to know that they're investing their money, you know, correctly. So you have to have a very good background. And I mean, luckily, I was in that multinational lung cancer control program, which gave me a stepping stone ahead of, you know, some other people I was probably contending with. You know, I had actual experience in public health. So that really helped. But I mean, there are people who are doing amazing things in South Africa that could be, you know, eligible to apply for these things and could actually get funding for it. So I don't think anybody should doubt themselves.
Okay. So I'm going to leave everyone else's question. I think we've covered all of that. And I want to get back to some of your shows because I've noticed that a lot of video on demand, particularly in Africa, has increased. For us, our Showmax platform, you know, you get Netflix, DStv, and Showmax. Our Showmax platform during lockdown showed like an increase of about 50% of video on demand content, which shows you how much people are going for it. And I was actually going to show you some of the shows that I actually enjoy. Let me show you. I'll go to my Netflix process. This is my Netflix. I do try. I'm here. Money Heist, guys.
I haven't started, but I'm going to start.
I'm on season 4. And then, I got you. It's got that bit of thinking, but crime, but we're robbing a bank, but there's still personality.
Yeah, I've watched the first three. I just haven't watched season 4.
Yes!
I haven't watched this one. I'm definitely gonna binge together. Yeah.
We're gonna binge together, so that's out. And I know I'm probably gonna go quite a lot. Also, what I like, I've liked go down. Self-Made. I've been hearing quite a lot. Inspired by Madam C.J. Walker. An African-American washerwoman rises from poverty to build a beauty empire and become the first self-made millionaire. I've been hearing quite a lot of reviews, so I'm glad that's there. So, yeah, this is usually my selection and my choice. And my favorite part, actually, is... Let me just check if it's here. And it will load. I'm quite a big fan of documentaries, particularly music documentaries from like music legends that have been there.
Me too.
I like some of those. Inside Bill Gates' brain. These are my type of favorite ones. Nina Simone.
I love that one.
Listen, I love things that can just take me away and be immersed, particularly if it's arts and culture, because I really love arts and culture. So a lot of things there. But you were telling me some of the things that you like. What are some of your shows?
Well, Three Identical Strangers, I think. That one is amazing. That talks about, for me, it's more about ethics. I don't want to spoil. Apparently, I'm a spoiler, so I don't want to go ahead and spoil everything. But just check it out. It's very amazing. It's like psychology. If you're into stuff that's related to psychology, definitely check it out. Conversations with the Killer, Ted Bundy tapes. Abducted in Plain Sight. Also watching one called Wild Wild Country.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Tell us about this one, Abducted in Plain Sight.
Yo, that one.
It's this one.
Girl, it's crazy. I mean, just a summary, like this girl was abducted by somebody more than once. And, you know, obviously sexually abused. And, you know, it's just like, it just goes to show that you could literally be living with a sociopath right next door, and they could be normal. They could be your dad's best friend.
Wow.
Yeah. But yeah, that's what interests me in these shows. It's like, it's crazy. The human mind, it's amazing. It's crazy.
Yeah, ne? But I'm also trying to figure out then, how much, be truthful, how much paranoia have you picked up from these shows?
Paranoid, to be honest. Especially now that I'm in Scotland, I mean, I often feel like as a Black person, I could be a target of some weird racial, I don't know, cult or something, you know? Like maybe something like, oh, we need a Black person. And, you know, there she is. We could just grab off the street. I mean, it's really made me paranoid. I'm not going to lie. But most of these shows are American. So it gives me that comfort that, you know, I'm not in America. So I'm okay. But yeah, it also tells you how to deal with people who could be sociopaths. Like you can from people telling their stories, you can, you know, gather the evidence that you need that, okay, if I see these signs, you know, then, you know, it could be. Your network.
It almost made me. I was even scrolling. I was like, "Stop telling me some data in Jehovah, Homa." But anyway, so I'm gonna have to end it. This is like going on and on. And I love it. I actually absolutely enjoyed it. Talk about two strangers, complete strangers, coming together to have a conversation.
Right.
I've absolutely enjoyed it. Thank you so much, Nate, for your time. So
thank you for having me.
What's on the cards for you in future? What's the next couple of months, years looking like? The future looking like?
Okay, I'd say people should follow me firstly on Instagram because I think I might start a blog. I might just do it. And yeah, I mean, once this lockdown is over, I'll be roaming, you know, Scotland with my camera and just take a few pictures and tell a few stories. I see a lot of stories that I could actually tell about this place. So yeah, stay tuned.
Oh, nice, nice. Thank you so much, Newa. We wish you well in your journey.
Thank you.
I'm actually inspired about your story, and it's always so nice to see a black going out there, conquering and doing absolutely amazing things. I think it's just so liberating for us to see and be like, yeah, girl, you go do it, make money, come back and feed us.
I definitely will. Thank you for having me.
But thank you so much. We wish you well and wishing you love, wishing you light, wishing you judgment, and we send you light. It probably will be hard, it will be difficult, but just know that we're behind you and we're rooting for you, and keep safe in this time, and know that we're always just a video call away.
Thank you. Nice meeting you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, everyone.
Bye. Bye. Right. Thank you so much, guys, for joining us right here on Lockdown Abroad. I hope you enjoyed that. That was absolutely amazing. We were connecting with Ismail Zondo all the way from Scotland, doing her PhD, 4 months into her PhD, pretty much giving us an idea of how her life is in the UK. Is she fine? Is she not? And obviously, one of the biggest concerns is that she's asthmatic and she's had to rethink quite a lot of things in her life, her schedule, her life, and her planning. But you know what? It's so good to see a big girl's doing amazing thing within the mental health space. Hey, they mean people exactly like me. Anyway, from me, guys, I have to love and leave you. And all that's left now is for me to explain to you what's happening tomorrow. In our Thursday edition of Lockdown Abroad, I'm going to be still staying in the UK. This time around, I'm going to be going to the city of London, where I'm going to be speaking to Unondumiso Mthembu, who is a technology consultant currently based in the city of London. She was born and raised in KwaZulu-Natal and further educated in the Eastern Cape at Rhodes University. Before settling down in Johannesburg, she moved into the United Kingdom almost 3 years ago. She also describes herself as somewhat of a wanderer who loves to travel. She's passionate about technology and loves cooking and is ready, loves cooking, reading, and listening to all kinds of music. So listen, I'm super excited for that one. So be sure to join us tomorrow at 12:30. 12:30 South African time. Please note that it's not 11 o'clock. It's 12:30 South African time. And for some of you, I'll try to upload this on social media as well as the full conversation on YouTube. Thank you so much for honoring the space, for honoring the moment and the conversation. And I'm sure you absolutely love our guests. Join us tomorrow for Lockdown Abroad with myself, Nandabego Sibisi. I'm over and out. Love and light is the power. Bye, guys.